In the early part of this presentation, I will set out approximately what I mean by medieval monasticism. This will then merge into a closer look at ancient monasticism in the Midlands and its significance. Then I'll discuss how and why ancient ecclesiastical sites in Ireland, in this case the Midlands, came to be as they are. And the final part of the presentation takes Saer Cearn in County Offaly as a case study showing just how much of the past can endure to the present at local sacred places. I hope this might then enable you to look afresh at ancient sites in your own locality, celebrating what survives and helping to preserve them. As an introduction to that, I'll show features at some of the selected local sites that seem to echo elements that are found at Saer Cearn. So, to begin by explaining what we mean by medieval monasticism. In Ireland, medieval monasticism occurred in two main phases. One starting around the middle of the first millennium, and the other starting around 1200 AD. The traces of these two phases of monasticism are quite different from each other on the ground. The Manahan Churchyard, County Offaly, seen here on the left, was originally a monastery founded by St. Monachon in the 7th century. Like many of these earlier sites, its most obvious surviving features today include a church, a graveyard, and a holy well. It looks quite different from Holy Cross Abbey in County Tipperary, shown on the right here, which was founded about 500 years later, towards the end of the 12th century. Whereas Le Manahan, like many of the earliest Christian sites in Ireland, has a slightly haphazard appearance in its surviving state, Holy Cross has a more organized appearance to it, an imposing rectangular structure, almost like Croke Park from the air, defined by strong stone buildings, including a church that is noticeably larger than the one at Le Manahan. The point of this slide is that just as Le Manahan is more or less typical of an early medieval insular monastery, so Holy Cross is a good example of a later medieval monastery, a European-style monastery, as we will see. To get an idea of how a site like Le Manahan might once have been, take a look at the excavated and conserved early monastery at Nendrum, County Down, shown here from the air, on the left. The reconstruction drawing of Glendalough on the right here gives a fuller impression of how such a monastery might have looked in its prime. It's a reconstruction drawing of Glendalough on the right, just to give you a sense, and you can see there are similarities in the enclosures and so on. Like Le Manahan, Nendrum and Glendalough belong to the first phase of Irish monasticism, a distinct insular tradition, often called Celtic, which flourished from the 6th to the 12th century. Here, for simplicity, I will occasionally refer to these first millennium monasteries as Celtic, although the term is not quite accurate. These Celtic monasteries are the sites at which you find decorated high crosses and round towers, the classic early Irish monastery. They are also the places where ornamental metalwork, like the Derry na Flann board, and priceless illuminated manuscripts like the Book of Kells were produced. At these sites, the inner curvilinear enclosure contains the oldest and most sacred part of the monastery, including the oratory, where the founding saint started off, and indeed, in that inner area as well, you normally find the founding saint's grave, or it was to be found at one time. As shown here, many of the monasteries acquired an outer enclosure too, reflecting their increasing size and prestige as time went on. Invariably, there was a holy well somewhere nearby, sometimes even within the monastic enclosure. Although the curvilinear enclosure is no longer visible on the surface at many early Irish ecclesiastical sites today, such as Glendalough, as it happens, the one that's reconstructed here on the right, in that case, the enclosure is not to be seen, except with excavation and geophysical survey and so forth. In other words, it's not to be seen on the surface. The second phase of monasticism in the Midlands, as elsewhere in Ireland, began in the 12th and 13th century with the arrival of newly established European orders, the Cistercians, Franciscans, Dominicans, Benedictines, Augustinians, Knights Templars, Knights Hospitallers, and many others, the names of which are familiar, the Carmelites, and so forth. Unlike the early Irish or Celtic monasteries, which grew and evolved outwards from the beginnings at the centre, the second millennium monasteries were built to a ready-made rectangular design. They arrived ready-made, in other words, more or less. From the air, whatever the religious orders, these tended to look something like what you see on the right here at Elephant, County Louth, or as we saw at Holy Cross in an earlier slide. They were rectangular in shape, as you can see, involving a set of buildings framing an open cloister. At Mellifont on the right here, most of the buildings were destroyed after the abbey was suppressed and confiscated at the time of the Reformation. But its layout was revealed again during archaeological excavations by Liam de Poer. This preordained building plan, reflecting the preordained set of rules required by the centralized church authority in Rome, was more or less common to all of the monasteries, abbeys, friaries, and priories established in the later Middle Ages. Many of these orders were founded on the continent in the 12th and 13th century, and they set up houses in Ireland within a very short time, often within a couple of decades of being founded. Sometimes even within the lifetime of the founding saint. So the two images on the slide can be taken as a generalized guide to medieval monasticism in Ireland. The one on the left is curvilinear, early, and insular. The one on the right is rectilinear, later, and imported from the continent. In many cases, not just one, but a couple of these European-style religious houses could be established in the same Irish town. And some were also established at the sites of earlier insular monasteries. Here on the left, at St. Faheen's well-known early medieval monastic site at Four in County Westmeath, for example, a Benedictine priory was built around 1200. And still stands there in the background of the photograph. You can see it down there in the fields. It's just low-lying, but a sort of cleaner grass around it, so to speak. That's the Benedictine Abbey down there. And it still stands in a partially ruined state today. So it's about built around 1200. As elsewhere, the wooden buildings from the time of St. Faheen, which would have stood somewhere in this picture, so to speak, at the time of St. Faheen and his earliest followers, sometime in the middle of the first millennium, they've long disappeared. There's no sign of those wooden buildings. And over time, maybe after three or four centuries, perhaps even later, the wooden buildings that had been built successively on the site to house the monastery, they were gradually replaced by stone buildings. And there in the foreground, you can see the original stone building that survives. It's there just close to the car park. It's in the bottom right-hand corner of the photograph on the left-hand side. That's the church that was built before the arrival of the Benedictines. In other words, at the later stage of the earlier monastery, when it had been in existence for maybe about 400 or 500 years, maybe even longer, but certainly before the 12th century. Two holy wells at the site and a water mill reflect the early days of St. Fahin's Monastery, even today, while sacred trees, ongoing devotion to the saint, and a great deal of folklore bear witness to the enduring impact of this early ecclesiastical phase. The Benedictine Abbey had a more passing influence, in spite of its more imposing structure and its impressive architectural sculpture, such as the cloister arcade, which is shown here on the right. That's that wonderful, architecture and sculpture that you can see there in the right-hand photograph is the cloister within that Benedictine Abbey that you can see down at the field. You can see it's very impressive. It's more impressive than any of the earlier material. Yet somehow it's the early life of the site that's remembered and that figures very strongly in the folklore of the site. This very fine Benedictine Abbey belongs to the time of the Normans, when castles began to appear in the landscape and many of our inland towns were born. Sometimes, by the way, the ancient monastic sites, you know, which were named after the local saints, St. Fahin in this case, they were given new names when these later monasteries were built during the time of the Normans. They were often given names like St. Mary's or something like that. But over time, they reverted back to the ancient name again. At the ancient Celtic monastic site of Ahabo in County Leash, two continental orders were introduced around the time of the Normans. First, an Augustinian priory was built on the site in the 1230s, and a Dominican friary, part of its remains shown here on the left, was built about 150 years later. So in other words, you have two sites, one Augustinian, one Dominican. The new monasteries flourished as the older ones faded. Now, by the older ones, I'm talking about the ancient Celtic ones, which had been around at this stage for 500 or 600 years or more. By the 16th century, when confiscations and closures of religious houses in Ireland began to occur by order of Henry VIII of England, we'll return to that later, these European orders had foundations all over Ireland, populated by Irish monks and nuns, and had themselves become part, very much an intrinsic part, of the late medieval Gaelic world in Ireland, as well as the more anglicized urban centers. So you'd find these monastic orders from Europe, the Franciscans, Dominicans, they were the most common ones all over the country, but also various other ones. You'd find them both in the towns and in rural areas. Sometimes, all that survives of a later medieval monastery today is the church building, possibly with associated fragments of other buildings and tomb effigies, or the name of a street or a road, such as Abbey Lane or Friar Street, or something like that in a town. You often get names like that in towns, even where there is nothing left of the original monastic building. But whether the community was enclosed, like the Cistercians, or more amongst the people, like the mendicant Franciscans, in its prime, the later medieval religious house tended to be a cloistered rectangular structure, like Kilconnell Franciscan Friary in County Galway, which is shown here on the right. You can see that that's not very different from the Cistercian Abbey of Mellifont, or the Cistercian Abbey at Holy Cross, for that matter, as well. Okay. Beg your pardon, sorry, I just jumped ahead of myself there. Our lecture is primarily concerned with monasteries in the heart of the Midlands, in counties Offaly and Laois. Many of the names are familiar to you, as you can see here on the right. Ahabo, Burr, Duro, Killeshan, Lemanahan, Rahan, Sarkirn, and Timahoe. But the story would be incomplete without noting some of the famous locations at the edge of this area, around the buffer zone, if you want to call it that. Places like Clonmacnoise on the Offaly side of the Shannon. In other words, it's within the counties. There in a flan just outside the counties, Lura and Terryglass, all in County Tipperary. Clonard in County Westmeath, and St. Bridget's famous monastic foundation in Kildare. These are all very famous places that are around the edge of the area we're talking about, showing, I suppose, the significance of this area in the early monastic period, in the first millennium. I just bear with me for 1 second. Oh, yes. It would also be incomplete. In other words, it's not just the ones within our area, the famous ones within our area, but also the famous ones on the edge that we've just mentioned. But also there is a third group that we have to mention, which are the lesser known sites within the area itself. This lecture is part of a larger project, which is especially focused on six specific sites in the counties Laois and Offaly, as shown here. Well known to you. Three in each county, Kilmanaman, Dysart Gallen, Clapook, Kilmorielli, Kilbride, and Monaster Oris. As seen in this image of Dysart Gallen on the right, not far from Port Laois in County Laois, all that survives of the once thriving early ecclesiastical community might be a late medieval church surrounded by a graveyard, often with a holy well somewhere nearby. In other words, there isn't much to sort of remind you of this great monastery that might have lived there, existed there at one stage. I suppose I should make an admission at this point. I don't know these local sites in the same intimate detail that many local people would, including some people who will be obviously listening to this. So do please forgive any omissions or errors of detail, but you'll be able to correct those yourselves. Clonard in County Meath is located northeast of our core area. It's a very famous place. But today there's very little surface trace of the thriving monastic school that was founded here by St. Finian at the beginning of the 6th century. It's thought that the modern church shown here stands on the site of his foundation. And there are plenty of later medieval earthworks and burials in the surrounding fields, including a fine Norman motte. However, little survives of St. Finian's monastery. On the other hand, it had a massive influence on the development of monasticism in Ireland, especially the Midlands. St. Finian is sometimes known as the teacher of the saints of Ireland, and his school at Clonard was the place at which several of the monastic founders were reputedly taught, notably Brendan of Burr and Brendan of Clonfert, Ciarán of Clonmacnoise, Columba of Terryglass, Ruan of Lura, Canis of Abo, and possibly Ciarán of Sire. I will just give you a moment to read the helpful information board on the right here. I'm sure you've had a chance to read it even as I was speaking. But just not to rush off just yet. The images on it, by the way, are obviously of a book reflecting the teachings of St. Finian and so forth. On the lower right, there's a font because a medieval font survives from the site. And on the right is just a mental image of the Norman motte, which is a lovely tree growing on top of it. Then, of course, there is Derry the Flan, located between Thurles and Killinall in County Tipperary. It's best known for the discovery of a liturgical hoard there around 1980, including an ornamental chalice and other metal objects. It was once a Cayley Day Centre, part of a re-energizing spiritual movement in the Irish Church during the 9th century. And this brings us to the driving energy of Irish monasticism, its spirituality. Very often, commentators speak about the I suppose the economic sort of importance of monasteries in early medieval Ireland and the riches and so on associated with them, and the fact that they might have been proto-towns, etc. And these are all valid points. However, there is a tendency, I suppose, in our more materialistic age to forget that these were actually centers of spirituality, and that's what drove what happened at them. We need reminding, I suppose, that the great high crosses, the manuscripts, and the metalwork were ultimately inspired by this spirituality and were designed to serve its ongoing health and promotion. It was this spirituality that led monks to seek a place of wilderness, a dísheart in Irish, Dísheart Gallen, to be away from worldly distractions. And it was the inspiring example of these monks that led others to follow them. These monasteries, as they grew wealthier over the centuries, gradually lost touch with the idealism of the founding generations and were ultimately left behind by the church reforms of the 12th century. On the western and eastern margins of the Midlands, the area we're speaking about, on the two sides, west and east, like Clonmacnoise, as I say, on the banks of the Shannon, shown here on the left, and Kildare to the right. It's planned shown here as well on the right-hand side. In a sense, Clonmacnoise is a crossroads site located where the Escarriada routeway across the Midlands, a very famous routeway in medieval Ireland, met the great north-south routeway, the River Shannon. Like Glendalough in County Wicklow, Clonmacnoise grew into a massive monastic site. It is so well known that we will leave it to look after itself. We won't really discuss it as part of this. That's not to downgrade it or anything like that. We want to emphasize the sites we're looking at, I suppose. Kildare on the right is associated with St. Bridget, and it reminds us that monastic foundations for women were a feature of the early Irish tradition, although their significance was often overlooked subsequently. I suppose it's being rediscovered now. The memory of St. Bridget, too, has been revitalized of late, but she has always been recognized as a major figure in the early ecclesiastical life of Ireland. Cogitosus, a 7th-century monk, recounted her life and described in some detail her monastic church at Kildare, which was built of wood and was the place where her remains were enshrined after her death. The restored cathedral we see in Kildare today was built in the 13th century, presumably on the site of St. Bridget's church, which had been destroyed by fire. Nearby is a round tower and fragments of early sculpture, while the curvilinear enclosure that originally surrounded the monastic site is thought to be reflected in the plan of the town and the streets round about the cathedral in the modern town of Kildare. The manuscript libraries of these great monastic sites were looted and variously damaged over the centuries, especially around the time of the Reformation. But rare survivals give us a glimpse into the liturgy, learning, and craftsmanship of these once thriving religious powerhouses. One such survival is the Book of Lura, also known as the Stow Missal, which was produced around the year 800 and was enshrined in an ornamental cover about 2 centuries later. The manuscript is much smaller than the Book of Kells, to take an example that many of you might have seen. The Book of Lura measures just 15 centimeters by 12 centimeters, which is about 6 inches by 5 inches. Now, these are just images of the Lura site. You might notice the church in the lower right, for example, it has what are known as ante, those little protrusions of the walls, the two side walls, which was also visible actually at St. Fihine's early church at Ford, the one that was built before the monasteries. Likewise here at Lura, you can see it. But we're not really here to speak in detail about Lura because it's off the edge of our core area, so to speak. But the Lura manuscript eventually ended up in the Royal Irish Academy and the cover shrine found its way into the National Museum of Ireland. So as we have seen, the buffer zone then around our core area of Laois and Offaly is surrounded by the surviving remains of influential and artistically productive monasteries from the early medieval period. So it's hardly surprising that within our area, there were important sites as well. The Book of Durrow, named after the monastic site where it was once kept in County Offaly, is now housed in Trinity College in Dublin. Although now smaller than it was originally, due to being trimmed, the pages being trimmed, the Durrow manuscript is larger than the one from Lara, measuring 245 millimetres by 145 millimetres. That's almost 10 inches by 6 inches. And it contains more than three times as many vellum folios or leaves as the Book of Lara. The Book of Durrow, produced around 700, the one we're showing here, contains text from the four Gospels, along with illuminated initial letters, carpet pages, and stylized portraits of the four evangelists. So here on the left, you have the portrait of St. Mark, depicted by a lion, his symbol. Anyone who's been to Venice will be very familiar with the lion as a symbol of St. Mark. Of course, in this case, the lion has been painted by someone who never saw a lion, as you can see. But they are representing the lion, nevertheless, as in a symbolic way, as a symbol of St. Mark, the famous evangelist. On the right, then, you can see a carpet page, just a page of ornamentation, and some illuminated initials from the Book of Durrow, which is one of the most famous manuscripts surviving from an ancient Irish monastery. You can see the initial is nicely done, but if you look at the carpet page, it brings out something, I suppose, that's interesting about these, and also the one on the left, which is that even though it's painted on a vellum page, it actually almost looks like metalwork with these little plates inserted, and other things around it. It's often pointed out that both the high crosses and the manuscripts, the organization of the design in them has the appearance that may well have been borrowed from metalwork. So this is the Book of Durrow. Along with these surviving manuscripts, there are other glimpses of the riches that once existed in the Midlands in our core area. Notably, for example, when the Fadden Moor Psalter was discovered in County Offaly some years ago. You can see some images here from, some on the top right, the appearance of it as shown by the National Museum. We also know that a spectacular manuscript was once kept at Sir Kieran in Thurene, County Offaly, known as Imirce Hiaráin. It was so special that it merited mention in the Leabhar Bracht. That was in the 14th century, when the Sir Kieran manuscript was already several centuries old and was still preserved at the Sir Kieran site. So it must have been quite spectacular to merit being mentioned in another book. Sadly, the one that was mentioned has long since disappeared. Now, mention of these manuscripts prompts me to raise another issue. The investment involved, not just in terms of time, learning, artistry, and skill and craftsmanship and so on, but also economically, I suppose, in livestock terms. The vellum making up the pages of these manuscripts was made from calf skins. It has been estimated, for example, that skins from about 180 calves were used in the production of the Book of Kells. That on its own is an extraordinary investment by any standard. Because remember, at that time, leather was of huge importance in the making of textiles and shoes and bags and everything else in those days when you didn't have plastic or any of those kind of things or made up sort of materials. So why are these early Irish monasteries so different from the ones that emerged on the continent? Why are they circular when the ones on the continent are rectangular? Well, the story goes back to the beginnings of Christianity. Jesus lived his life in Judea and Galilee, with Samaria in the middle. I have dropped a black dot, as you can see, down there in the lower right-hand corner, a black dot with a white ring around it, on the general area that we're talking about, so that you can find it easily on the map. This territory, known as the Holy Land, lay within the Roman Empire, shown here in red. And the early church spread westward within that empire, modeling its diocesan structure on the Roman system. Now, as you know, Jesus' life was lived within the Roman context. He was crucified under the supervision of the Romans and so forth. The early church, the early evangelizing spread into the Roman world, places in which the Romans were already. St. Paul wrote to these various cities, Ephesus in Greece, you can see it's within the empire, Rome, Corinth, and so forth. All of these places were within the empire. And the church then spread westward along the empire. And it modeled itself on the organization of the empire. And that's how we ended up with the diocesan system, so to speak. Many Roman forts from the early centuries AD are known in Britain, which, as again you can see in the map, was within the Roman Empire by the first century AD and through the first few centuries AD. Many of these Roman forts were built in Wales, for example, and other parts of the western edge of Britain, just across the sea from Ireland. They're typically Roman in design. You can see it there in the lower left. Rectangular, straight lines, organized, all very different from the Celtic type of activity shown above. The earliest Christian churches too were rectangular in the Roman tradition. In other words, rectangular churches. Ireland, however, remained outside the Roman Empire, as you can see there on the map again, and the native tradition of constructing curvilinear landmarks, which had been going on for thousands of years, continued and flourished, as you can see on the left here on the Hill of Tara on the top left. These great curvilinear enclosures were being built at Tara and at Rathcrahan, Owen Macha, many other places around Ireland, at the same time that the Romans were building their massive rectangular forts in Britain and on the continent. Two different traditions. In Ireland, in the centuries after St. Patrick's time, the equivalent of today's farmyard was a circular enclosure, as shown here on the right. It's known as a ring fort by archaeologists, but very often in a local area, it's known as a rath or a list. If built of stone, it's often called a cashel. And if it's found on water, it's known as a crannog. And, you know, it has wooden ramparts around it instead of soil or instead of stone or whatever. The space inside these enclosures is often about 30 or 40 meters across, with wooden houses originally and other normal dwelling features, of course, which you can't see today on the ground because they have rotted away. Sometimes there are more than one surrounding rampart. These circular enclosures are known all over the Irish countryside and were the normal secular dwelling places during the early centuries of Christianity in Ireland. Now, if we turn our attention to an ecclesiastical site of the same period, Cooleshiel, here in County Offaly, the top left, we can see that the religious communities of that period simply lived in the same type of enclosure as their secular neighbours, just as the religious community today would have houses something similar to the houses in which secular people lived. However, ecclesiastical enclosures are distinguished in the early Christian system by features that are specific to themselves, one of which is the occurrence of a holy well, In this case, within the enclosure, Gulishal. The bottom picture shows the holy well within the enclosure, and in the top image, you can actually see the line of the well running down from that holy well down from right to left. There are some trees there where the well is in the aerial image of the site, and then the well runs off down in a sort of a from right to left across the site. And very often the site itself, or maybe the holy well associated with the site, carries the name of the founding saint. In this case, this well is the well of Saint Kieran of Sire, same saint associated with Sir Kieran. The photo on the lower left shows Saint Kieran's well at Gulishal, as it is today, flowing off as a stream, as we said. The reconstruction drawing of a ring fort on the left is based on sound research, showing circular wooden huts within the enclosure, connected by cobbled areas and surrounded by a protective rampart. This is as it might have looked maybe about the 7th century or something like that in Ireland. In the case of ecclesiastical sites, ongoing activity over all the centuries since they were founded, including the building of later stone churches and other structures, as well as the digging of graves, has obliterated much of the evidence for the ancient wood buildings that once stood in these places. However, we have a good idea of what these buildings might have been, not just from excavated evidence, but also by looking at island sites off the Atlantic coast to the west, and sometimes mainland sites in remote areas like the Dingle Peninsula in County Kerry. In these cases, the early ecclesiastical sites were built of stone for want of trees, and the early structures have survived, as at Inishmurry here off the coast of County Sligo, shown on the right. They can see the classic curvilinear enclosure, rather like a ring fort. Note the circular hut, as in the ring fort, there in the foreground, and a similar protective rampart in stone, as we said. But note the rectangular structures as well. These are the two churches at the site. The church building was sometimes introduced with Christianity from the Roman Empire, of course, and it is no surprise that it took the rectangular shape favored in Roman building. In other words, all the normal features are classic Celtic, but the church is an introduced form and is rectangular. And at many small ecclesiastical sites from these early Christian centuries, it is the church that stands out. Usually, as in this case, the surviving church building is a later medieval structure, which sometimes retains part of the masonry from an earlier stone church, which in turn would have been built on the site of a wooden church. But the rectangular form survives all the way through, and more often than not, the location survives as well. In other words, the church is built on the site of the original wooden church. I now propose to look at, before I move on, I want to just do this one here, my apologies for Kilbury Alley, because I wanted to make a point about this. In some cases, the actual rectangular, even in the Midlands and areas like that, where there has been a lot of agricultural and various other activity, a lot of destruction as well through the Reformation, etc., very often the circular original site has survived. In this case, at Kilbury Alley, as you can see, the actual circularity of the site has survived, so to speak, and the circular enclosure. Here, as you can see, the ground within that enclosure has built up over the centuries as successive churches and dwelling huts and graves were built one after the other over time, graves were dug, etc. Even when a circular enclosure is no longer visible at one of these sites, here it is, but very often it's not, we can be reasonably confident that it once existed at almost every one of these sites from the first millennium. and the mark of its ditch is often still there, even if it can't be seen on the surface. It will be there underground. And this is where archaeologists use modern technology to show the fill of the ditch standing out within, you know, under the ground, because it's different types of material. Using the right technology, you can actually identify this ditch even when it's not visible on the surface. Now to take a look at Sir Kieran and, you know, some of its maybe lessons for ourselves as well. Sir Kieran is interesting not only because of its own fascinating history, its surviving medieval remains, and its place in the heart of the local community, but also as an indication of features that might exist elsewhere, whether known already or still waiting to be discovered, possibly in this project. The early monastery at Sir Kieran was established by St. Kieran of Sire in the 5th or 6th century AD, and it still plays a role in the life of the local community. The medieval pilgrimage tradition has lived down to the present, and the feast of St. Kieran is still celebrated on the 5th of March. That day, the 5th of March, and the feast of St. Kieran, which is still alive today, was mentioned in the Martyrology of Angus around 800 AD. Its heyday as a monastic centre was undoubtedly the 8th, the 9th, and the 10th century, when it was enclosed with a great double rampart shown here. You can see that, you know, remains of that great rampart. It's quite massive, with the churchyard at the centre. This was the time when the high cross was carved at the site, when the illuminated manuscript Imirce Chiron was painted, and the kings of Ossory were interred at the site. Very lot of association between the royal family, if you want to put it that way, the kings of Ossory and the site itself. It grew into a great monastic school, and at some stage a round tower was built. Almost certainly a shrine would still have marked the grave of the founding saint, Sir Kieran, at the heart of the monastery, where the modern churchyard is located today. He's in there somewhere. But this was also the most perilous time in the life of this monastic site, this time around the 8th, 9th, and 10th century. During the 9th and early 10th century, there were a number of Viking raids on the monastic site. You would think, what were they doing coming in to the middle of Ireland? But they did. However, it was not just the Vikings. In 739 AD, 60 years before the arrival of the Vikings, the annals record that the abbot of Sir Kieran was slain. And that wasn't the Vikings. So the Irish were up to it too. Sir Kieran was under the patronage of the kings of Ossory, and being on the edge of the kingdom was presumably a target for raids from neighbouring kingdoms. From higher ground to the southwest, approximately 300 metres away, an impressive triple-banked ring fort, sadly levelled about 50 or 60 years ago, looks down over the monastic enclosure. It's not easy to pick out the ring fort today, but the yellow arrow on the left shows its barely visible footprint where it once stood. It's been levelled, but the arrow shows where it is with the two red dots below it, and you can see some of the curvilinear sort of shape of the ring fort still. It's more clearly visible on the 25-inch map shown on the right. Again, it's shown with an arrow, as you can see in that map. On the arrow on the right-hand side, the green arrow on the right-hand side shows the monastic site, and the green arrow on the left-hand side in that map shows that multi-ramparted ring fort, which is on higher ground looking down over the monastic site. Now, the ring fort was inhabited at the same time as the monastery and would presumably have been a reminder of the close ties between the local secular power and the ecclesiastical site. In other words, this is our site. It might also explain why raids took place at the site. Very often in these monasteries, the abbot might even be a member of the local you know, the family that gave the kings as well. At Clapook, which is one of the six sites we mentioned, it's shown here. The churchyard, when I said the six sites we mentioned, is one of the ones in the medieval churches project with which this lecture is associated. The churchyard surviving today, with its location shown here by the lower arrow, and you know, in the middle there, is also sited about 300 meters from a fort, just like at Sir Kieran. In this case, the Dún of Clapook, a fortification located on a high rocky prominence with a view over the countryside in all directions, again, looking down over the monastic site, just as at Sir Kieran. As you can see, the Dún is tree covered today, but it presumably wasn't always that way. Sites carrying the name Dún tend to be very early in Irish history, and their beginnings usually predated St. Kieran, or St. Patrick, I should say. In later medieval times, there was a tower house castle on the site of the hill fort here at Clapook. In other words, that top arrow just up in that area there, there was a tower house. Tower houses were typically built around the 15th, 16th century. Some maybe even in the 14th, but usually about the 15th century was the big period into the 16th century. It's very likely that the Dún had been a prominent stronghold during the early medieval centuries too. In other words, you have the name Dún suggesting a ramp, you know, a fortification early, maybe even before the time of St. Patrick. You have a tower house on the site suggesting it was still important in the later medieval period around the 15th, 16th century. And it's almost certain that it would have been important in between as well. In other words, it was a key center, so to speak, of power. The partially ruined church at Clapook derives from the later medieval centuries, and there's no mention of a holy well nearby, which one would normally expect at an early ecclesiastical site. So there may be one that's just, I just haven't seen a mention of it. On the other hand, the graveyard itself surrounding the church is D-shaped, as you can see here in the map, under the aerial photograph, I should say. The D-shaped is not that larger field to the left of the arrow, but it's the little enclosure that the arrow is pointing at. You can see the little church building in the middle of it, and then the D-shaped enclosure giving on to the roadway there. Given that suggests, you know, that curvilinear enclosure around the church would suggest an early ecclesiastical site. Given the presence of the ancient hill fort nearby, this is a site of considerable interest and promise. This should be a really interesting one to study, Clapook. Now, coming back again to the Sir Kieran enclosure, we notice that the ground in the interior, in other words, the great circular ramparts there, they enclose ground which is uneven. You can see there are ridges and things like that to be seen on it. Evidence of medieval field plots. And then on the rampart, covered in trees there, but shown by the yellow arrow, there's a rectangular mound. Its location shown there, you know, and it's on the ramparts. These ancient features seem to reflect the changes that occurred at the site from the 12th century onwards. In other words, it had been an early monastery, great enclosure around it, school, a place associated with the kings of Austria and so on. But in the 12th century, changes took place. The rectangular mound may have been built around the time that Sir Kieran was granted to the young Norman Theobald Walter, who later became the chief butler of Ireland and gave the name Butler, the Earls of Ormond. The uneven ground to the right of the churchyard here may be the remains of the rural borough or village settlement that grew up after permission for a fair at the site was granted in the 1280s. This borough was quite sizable, and you know, thrived, obviously, because it was still recognized in the 16th century, 400 years later. A borough is essentially a sort of a village or a small rural town, I suppose, where citizens had certain rights, etc. There was also an Augustinian priory at Sarkirn at this time. Now, the Augustinians were introduced around this time, and we'll mention this again in a few minutes. But at this point, we might note that it was quite common for the Augustinian priests in particular, to be introduced to these ancient monastic sites from the 12th century. The Augustinian rule was more flexible than the rule of St. Benedict, which was the one followed by the Cistercian abbeys, for example. And it's possible that it was this flexibility that allowed the Augustinians to settle maybe more seamlessly into the old Irish tradition, which was less respectful of the Roman tradition. You know, the old Irish tradition had grown up slightly more independently, and the Augustinians seemed to fit in quite comfortably into this at many of these early sites when the Augustinians arrived around the 12th century. The later medieval appearance of Sarkirn is reflected to a certain extent at Monasterorus in County Offaly, another one of the sites in the medieval churches project. Monasterorus, shown here from the air, is clearly a very complex site with ecclesiastical ruins indicated at a few locations around the place on the Ordnance Survey maps. The presence of a holy well and the inclusion of the term monaster in the place name suggests strongly that this was an early medieval monastic site, in other words, a Celtic type one. But we know for certain that the Franciscans were certainly here because a Franciscan friary was built there in 1325. So this seems to be one rather like four, you know, where you had the early ecclesiastical site and then something is brought in Norman times in 1325. That's well into Norman times, obviously. As the holy well is near to the churchyard, number one here in the photograph, this is presumably the heart of the original Celtic monastic site. Number two is a Norman motte, a standard circular version in this case, but you might compare it with the rectangular one at Sarkirn. Both three and four are described on the maps as the ruins of monasteries. Now, it's, you know, that would be part, I suppose, of ongoing study to find out what's going on there. Stretching from the lower left corner here, roughly where the number five occurs on this aerial map, you can see the remains of earthworks. If you look closely, they're very regular, especially around the number five there. And they may be from the medieval town that's known to have been founded here and later deserted. In other words, a deserted medieval town, a deserted medieval village, a DMV, as they're often called. While the less regular earthworks up around the Norman motte, number two, are presumably the remains of associated farming activity, or maybe not. But this is clearly another one of those sites that has fascinating things to reveal, obviously, over time. By the 16th century, the ancient monastic sites of Ireland had experienced 1,000 years of development, although their glory days were now far behind them. Most had survived the ecclesiastical reforms of the 12th century in various ways, by becoming parish centres, often with an associated Augustinian priory, or by being occupied by religious houses of the new continental orders, or occasionally by becoming diocesan centres. However, everything changed in the 1530s and 1540s, during the final 10 years of the reign of Henry VIII, when his practice of dissolving monasteries in England was extended to Ireland. By around 1550, around 200 of the estimated 400 religious houses in Ireland had been suppressed and confiscated, including Saint Kieran, pictured here, which was burned down in 1548 and dissolved in 1552. I remember seeing something, you know, sort of one of these laconic comments, you know, in one of the surveys or something like that around this time or slightly later, that this was once church land, but it now belonged to the king, just like that. It's difficult to identify the remains of the medieval Augustinian priory at Saint Kieran today, but the best bet is that it once stood just outside the churchyard. They often did, the Augustinian ones, they often stood just outside the ancient churchyard. And you can see here where it's shown by the yellow arrow, that may well be the location. There certainly is evidence of a building there, the foundations of some sort of a building. At the same corner of the churchyard, an old, half-buried and long-disused doorway occurs in the graveyard wall. You can see it in the photograph there on the right. And this might at once say, you can see it had an arch sort of a covering over it. This might once have given access from the Augustinian priory to the churchyard and, of course, the ancient church and the founder's grave, etc. Only the base of the ancient round tower survives. That would obviously have been the most spectacular feature at this site and the most obvious feature from roundabout. But only the base can be seen there in the top right-hand corner of the churchyard. You can see the base of it. Also, of the great high cross that stood here, only the base survives today. But that base is very highly decorated, suggesting that the high cross that stood in the base was actually itself highly decorated as well. But there is no evidence of that cross today apart from the base. Is the cross buried in the churchyard or somewhere nearby? Was it destroyed and carted off? It's difficult to know. But it wasn't just Saint Kieran. Similar changes are likely to have occurred throughout the Midlands. In 1541, for example, the Lemanahan monastic site was destroyed and the shrine of the founder, Saint Monachon, which we see here in the image, was removed to Kilcolgan Castle in County Galway. This shrine, treasured not just for its medieval craftsmanship, but even more so, I suppose, at that time, because it contained the remains of Saint Monachon himself, is now housed in the 19th century Catholic Church at Bore near Ballycumber, about 5 kilometres from its original home at Lemanahan. But that too site suffered, as did most other sites as well. But neither burning and destruction, nor dissolutions and changes of ownership could shake the attachment of local people to these sites. Again, I'm taking Saint Kieran as an admittedly special case. Here, the medieval pilgrimage associated with the site has endured down to the present, as we mentioned. On the 5th of March, the feast day of St. Kieran, the pilgrimage begins with Mass in the Catholic Church, 1A here in the aerial image, at the foot of Bell Hill, which is actually number one. A landmark associated with the legend of the saint's life. So Bell Hill is very important in the life of the saint, in the story of how he came to the locality. The next station is St. Kieran's Well, number two, down there near the bottom of the aerial photograph. That's the Holy Well. So people move down there now. And then they move on to number three, which is actually the Holy Tree associated with St. Kieran. So it's Bell Hill down to St. Kieran's Well, onto St. Kieran's Bush, the tree, the Holy Tree, which we'll mention again in a few moments, and then back up to the ancient churchyard number four. Now, if you follow that on foot, you're going in a clockwise direction, which is the classic medieval pilgrimage, it was always in Ireland, it was always a cross clockwise pilgrimage. You always it was always a deschel. You kept the holy sites on your right. You traveled in a clockwise direction around the pilgrimage location, and when you came to each station, you traveled clockwise around that while you were praying. And that was the classic pilgrimage. Now today, people don't walk, it's not accessible to go that way at the moment. So people still, they travel by cars very often, but they will still go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, still maintaining that tradition, that very important tradition. In addition, there's a lot of folklore associated with the pilgrimage of Saint Ciaran to Saint Ciaran. And some of it is connected with nighttime. If you're not able to be there on the day, there are stories that it's better to travel around the pilgrimage site on your own at night. And there's also stories that there was a perpetual fire kept lighting at this site, just as at St. Bridget's site at Kildare. So you can see a little linkage there with another Midland site, one out on the edge. Of course, that's both of these are at the very beginnings of Christianity. So St. Ciaran is reputed to have been one of the four saints that went ahead of St. Patrick in Ireland. And of course, St. Bridget is right there at the beginnings of Christianity as well. In daily life too, the importance of passing the places associated with St. Ciaran in a clockwise fashion has endured down to the present. I love this particular situation here. It's a classic local situation. St. Ciaran's Bush is on the side of the Roscrea to Kinnegy Road as it approaches Clareen from the south. It stands out, the bush that is, because it's festooned with votive rags, as is tradition with these sacred trees. And you can see the tree there, you know, at the top of the photograph, more or less in the center, with all the white cloths and so on it. As you can see, a lay-by has been left around the tree. This is to ensure that people have the option of passing the pilgrimage station in a clockwise fashion, irrespective of the direction they are traveling. This is important locally, and it's noticeable that local traffic traveling towards Clareen, in other words, from us here on the foreground, off there to the distance, that local traffic will tend to divert around the lay-by as a matter of course, whereas unwitting passers-by follow the main road. Now, I was actually on a coach once, and we traveled along here, and we stopped, and I was talking about this very point when along came someone on a tractor and trailer and diverted in around by the lay-by and did exactly what I was talking about. This is the classic, that's how you'll tell the difference between a local car and a stranger passing by. Many local communities have maintained a link with traditional locations and beliefs and practices associated with ancient ecclesiastical sites in their neighborhood. Inherited beliefs in the powers of holy wells associated with local saints is very common, and burial in churchyards on the location of ancient ecclesiastical sites has usually endured. I'm aware of many of these. In fact, I'm thinking of one in particular now in County Wicklow as I speak, where there is no road up to the churchyard. It carries the name of an early saint, it's Kild McGig, and coffins right up to almost the present day being carried across the fields up to that graveyard. And this is quite common in many parts of the countryside, that there are these ancient sites that carry names like Kild McSomething or whatever, you know, association with early saints. Today, with a greater focus on local heritage, as you can see here, communities are becoming increasingly involved, not just in relearning and celebrating what has been forgotten about their own venerable places, but in conserving and protecting the sites for future generations, including the associated biodiversity. And I think this is an important point, interesting in relation to the Holy Wells in particular, for example. It's important, I think, that biodiversity is emphasized today as part of our heritage, just like our Christianity in a sense, because the biodiversity is a feature that's often mentioned in the lives of the early saints. Nature often features these. And I'm not going to go on at length about this, but I thought it was sort of something I would just throw in at the end. And really, we are at the end. And maybe with these comments, I'd like to bring the presentation to a close. And thank you very much. A
couple of sort of comments and questions. One of the things you said that's always been a question of mine is you said that the later churches are often built on the site. So you'd have the wooden church, the early stone church, and then the later.
Yeah.
Do you mean literally on the site? Do you mean literally on top of?
Well, I suppose not following necessarily the same footprint, but very often on top of,
That's interesting. But then the later, the Norman phase, that would be built adjacent to or beside. They don't build it on top. They choose a new site. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, they use very often. In fact, they're, like you saw at Fern, Steve, you know, with the Augustinians, to the side or whatever, you know.
No, it's really interesting. Yeah. And then I saw when you put up the images of Sir Kieran and Clapook, and I want to go and look at the Esker maps. And I thought about Clan MacNoise as well, that the monasteries are low lying, and then the fortifications or the secular stuff has. And what I wanted to ask you is, you could look at it two ways. You could look at it as having a dominant position over them, or you could look at it as having a protective.
Oh yeah.
Do you think it's both, or one or the other? Or
yeah, I think it's a fair point, Steve. I mean, maybe. I think it's a fair point. You see, as you know, like the story seems to be the saint as told. You know what I mean? It's obviously oversimplified, but the saint comes to the locality, convinces the king of Christianity. The king gives the saint a plot of ground to build the monastery. Now, if you imagine the same situation today, and you were granting, if a new religion came to the country, you know, you can almost see it happening today. And the old religion is being left behind, and you want to give a plot of ground to the new people. What do? You take the existing, you know, the existing plot of ground that was being used for pagan, you know. So in other words, there's an intrinsic link, I think, in, you know, the pre-Christian world between the king and the sacred sites. And I think that intrinsic link continues into the early Christian centuries. And your point about it being protective is absolutely right. But we know that the abbot was often a member of that family. Yeah. So they obviously are just, you know, they're very closely linked, Steve, I think, you know. But I think there was also an element of, you know, these riches are my riches. They're not, don't come near it.
Yes, absolutely,
you know.